Okay, folks, let's get started. Seems like I have received feedback from my organization friends that they are able to see me. You are able to see me as well as you are able to hear me. Given the interest of time, I'm going to get started. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm hoping and assuming you are able to see my screen now. You are able to hear me. So today we are going to talk about the agile transformation layers. I see that we have quite a lot of attendees already. More than 600 odd attendees. I'm really very happy to see that there are so many attendees attending this session. I so wish I could be in front of you and be able to see you, and we'll be able to talk to each other. But we are where we are. The other way to look at it is because we are on this particular medium, at least I'm getting to so many people. So thank you very much once again for attending. Let's get started. So the agenda for today, folks, is we'll spend some time trying to know each other, and I will need the help for the organizers to get the polls set up. And through that, we'll try to get to know each other. We'll try to spend some time looking at what is the transformation. We'll try to see why agile transformation is needed, what are the drivers behind it, what are some of the industry trends around agile transformation. Post that, we will actually try to get into the layers of agile transformation. We will look at certain areas within each of those layers and path forward for the transformation. So really speaking, it's a very simple agenda. And I'm really hoping that towards the end, at least I'll be able to open it up for question and answers for those who want to ask the questions. So here we go. Let me introduce myself. I guess Pallavi was planning to do that, but this is me. Been in the industry for close to 26 years now. My first agile experience or exposure started way back in 2007. Was working for the largest private insurer for property and casualty in the United States at that point of time. And since then, the agile bug has bitten me and has not left me yet. So currently, I'm working as the head of agile coaching practice in Fiserv. Over the years, I've worked in multiple roles, multiple capacities, most of the time working with Fortune 50 companies, providing them delivery solutions, and consulting on earlier testing processes and now agile adoption. So that's a brief introduction for myself. While I'm introducing you professionally, I also wanted to introduce myself a little bit of personally, because we always feel if there is a personal connect, we can talk with each other better. So little bit about myself. My hobbies, being born and brought up in Pune, typical Punekar at the core. Given that, theater is obviously my hobby since my childhood. Even today, whichever way I can find time, I try to find time to devote to my theater hobby. I used to be an avid reader, a decent reader nowadays. Do want to read fiction, non-fiction, Marathi, English, anything that I can. But daily, I need to read at least 5 to 7 pages. Very recently, I've picked up biking as my hobby. Have gathered a group of my dear friends from my office, and it's been really going great. Golfing is something of a hobby that I have picked up in the when I was in the US. Have not been so regular with it so far, but always up for chasing the white ball on the greens. And besides that, traveling is also something that I am very interested in, locally, globally, nationally, internationally. I do like to travel, experience the local flavor, local cuisine, the local culture. Talking to people really gives me a high. So that's about myself. we are going to open for a poll, and I hope I will be you. If you go to polls, there is a poll that I'm going to launch. You should be seeing a poll there for you to select your option. I'm assuming you can, you know, you are able to select the options there. There are four options. Yes, I can see the votes are coming. Excellent. Keep them coming, guys. We'll keep the poll open for another 30 seconds. 62%, 50 more than 50% of associates, the participants are in organizations which are more than 5,000 associates, which is a pretty big number. So we've got people from big organizations. I'm really happy to learn that. I'll keep the poll open for another 5 seconds. All right, thank you so much, guys. So, you know, I see that we have folks primarily, you know, a good 90% or more people who are working in organizations which are medium or large size. So very good to hear that. So let's get to know each other a little more. Let us talk about your role in your organization. And 1 sec. I'm launching the poll now. Again, let's do it for another 40 seconds. Let's understand your role in the organization. Either you're an agile enabler, you're you know, a practitioner, meaning, you know, someone from a Scrum team member, a delivery a team member, a developer, a tester, or a BA. Are you part of the management team? Are you part of the senior management team? Or are you part of the agile enabler community? All right, we'll keep that poll open for a little more time. All right, okay, I'm going to close the poll now. Only 35% of the people could vote, but I see that half of the population here is part of the delivery team. So very good to hear that. You know, we have practitioners, a good combination of practitioners and enablers, and on this forum, almost an even keel. So let's start with the third poll, and I'm going to launch that poll now. It should tell me about where exactly you are in your agile journey. Whether you've started your agile journey very recently, you've been there for more between 6 to 2 years, 6 months to 2 years, between 2 years to 5 years, or more than 5 years. We'll keep the poll open for 20 more seconds. Very good. Few more seconds. All right. Seems like an almost even keel across four layers. So good to know that we have people from across the layer, across the different experience layers on Agile. So good to know a good combination of practitioners and managers, enablers. Good to know that people from different stages of their agile adoption. So let's jump right into it. So let's talk about what is transformation. Transformation in any way typically has a current situation and a situation that you strive to be, something that you want to be in the future. So by nature, there is a transition involved. Now, depending on the context of the transformation, the transition may be several days, it could be several months, several weeks. And for example, in an agile, something like an agile transformation, it could be several years, right, before we reach the stage where we are closer to the stage where we want to reach. Typically, you know, if I were to use a cliched example of a transformation, you know, a caterpillar turning into a butterfly. I mean, we would have heard this metaphor so many times. Well, something to be learned from this is there is an inherent growth that is expected in this. There is an inherent change that is expected in this. But at the same time, you are maintaining your original qualities. Or if you are a person like me, who has over the years felt that need to shed some kilos, right? You know, those of you who've gone through this transformation, shedding some kilos and trying to be fitter fitter version of yourself, you definitely know that this kind of a transformation needs a lot of efforts, a lot of conscious decisions. The journey can be tough at times. There are times when you really need to relook of the progress that you've made and then course correct to the future that you want to reach. So this is typically what a transformation is, and the agile transformation is not much different, right? So the agile transformation is typically done in organizations which are dealing with businesses. And before we actually get into the agile transformation, since it's a business transformation, what is a business transformation typically focusing on? Business transformation typically, when it undergoes a transformation, looks for efficiency and improvement, you know, by removing waste in the system, by reducing the work in progress so that you are focusing on finishing your tasks rather than working on too many tasks at the same time. When eventually you get better at it, when you improve your efficiency, you start getting some business gains, right? And what kind of business gains are those? Those are typically improving your cycle time, your throughput, how quickly you can achieve certain tasks, and by that means reducing the cost per unit. That's what typically typical business gains that you will get from these efficiency improvements, which then should result into a delta for your customers, meaning your customers start feeling more happy. They get kind of experience that they want to be with you. So you have more satisfied customers and your customer retention is higher. Typically, that's what a business transformation is focusing on. And the agile transformation is not much different, right? So an agile transformation would get you an improved time to market. If I think that is probably one of the key drivers that we see that you know, people adopt agile for. They want to improve their time to market. If today I'm taking, let's say, 6 months to get my next version of my product out in the market, I want to get it out sooner. If you are in the business and cutthroat competition like the retail giants, competition with the retail giants like Amazon and Flipkart, you probably want to get your version out into production several times a day, right? So that is what you would typically focus on, which would help you to bring an improvement in overall productivity, and which should then eventually give a more quality experience to your customers. So these are the drivers for adopting agile and going through agile transformation. Now, changing gears, let's look at what the industry has been saying after they have adopted to agile. So what you see here on the screen is a snapshot from the latest State of Agile survey, which is conducted by Virgin One. So this is a snapshot of the benefits that the respondents to this survey have said that they have received after they have adopted to Agile. Remember the three ones that we talked about: improving time to market, improving productivity, getting better quality out for your customer. Now, remember, you know, Agile journey have started for people for quite some time. In here itself, we saw that more than 50% of our participants here itself have been in this journey for more than 5 years. So they do you know, see some benefits, as you can see here, but the top three reasons are still not the top three benefits that we claim to have received through at least from this survey. And this survey is by no means a smaller survey, several thousand of participants participate in this, right from practitioner all the way to C suit level people. So this is a very safe for us to assume that this is a reflection of the reality. So why is it that still when we say that we have benefited from Agile, the real drivers are not at the top, are not the top benefits that we have received? The survey further goes down into this detail and then actually has found out that a vast majority of the respondents, every third respondent out of the four respondents, say that their organization is still below high level of agile practices competency, that they still need help to get to that level of higher maturity in their agile adoption. They need training, they need coaching, you know, even after adopting Agile for so long. Which means, although we have started on this journey of Agile and we have experienced certain benefits, we are still not getting the benefits that we are looking for. I have a reason to believe that there are scientific reasons behind this, that this is happening because we are not looking at the Agile transformation the way we should be looking at it. We are not looking at Agile transformation holistically. And what we are going to talk about, my friends, in the next 30 odd minutes is just about that. But before we do that, there is again a poll time. I would love to hear from you. The next poll is, what is the most pressing issue that your teams face today? Just have launched the poll. Please participate in the poll. The poll options are, our teams struggle to have scrum ceremonies, our backlogs are starved and teams struggle to complete it, there are spillovers of stories, the management important tasks take priority over sprint tasks, and the last one is, we actually don't face any of the problems mentioned above. Thanks for responding. We are doing really well. Great response. I will keep the poll open a little longer this time because this is really at the crux of our discussion. We'll keep the poll open for a minute or so. Good to see almost 25% participation, more than 25% participation. All right, since we've reached the 40% participation, let's take a pause here. Let's look at the results. So 8% of you are saying that you are struggling to have your basic scrum ceremonies completed. 23% of you are saying that your backlogs are starved, your teams are struggling to complete work. Almost one fourth of you are saying that the spillovers of stories is a regular phenomenon. And almost a third of you are saying that the management important tasks come in between and take priority over the sprint tasks. A good 13% of you are saying that they actually don't face any of the problems mentioned above, which I'm actually very glad to see this. We should really, through different forums, try to understand how you've been able to overcome these problems that we've mentioned above. What I'm going to talk about is my way of thinking how we can overcome these problems. These problems are typically symptoms of your agile transformation struggling somewhere. You're getting started, you've started on your agile transformation, but you're not getting the benefits that you set out for, right? So that is where we are. And thanks for participating. So let's get into the actual content here. So I believe that the agile transformation is a multi-layer transformation. There are multiple layers involved here, and the first and foremost of that layer is an alignment layer. What do we mean by alignment? Typically, at the core of agile implementation is delivering to for the customer. Remember, the first principle first of the 12 principles in Agile Manifesto talk about customer satisfaction is our topmost priority. somewhere down the line, one of the principals also says that the business and IT people work together daily to achieve the common goals till the end of the project, right? So there is an inherent expectation that the business side, who represent the interests of the customer, and the IT side, who's making the technology solutions available, they need to be aligned. And I believe that the role that really helps that alignment is the product owner role that typically brings this transformation. And when the product owner role or some other enabler roles bring this transformation, what type of benefits do we get? There is a shared vision, there's a shared product vision of product with IT. You know, if you take the IT people out and ask them what are they working on in this, okay, I have a feedback that I'm not audible. I don't know how to get audible. Pallavi, if you are there, can you see if there is any technical difficulties? Or if you are able to hear me, you know, just let me know that you are able to hear me.
Yes, yes, Mayuresh, we can hear you clearly.
Okay.
So we can see the questions as well.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Very good. Thank you. Thanks for the feedback. So what happens with this is the IT and product has a shared vision, which is absolutely important for us to deliver on the promise that we have given to our customers. What we will also see is we'll see healthy backlogs, meaning since the product and the tech are working together, the backlogs of stories and features is constantly updated, and the teams are not starving for work, and hence the team are able to produce very regularly. There is a consistent business value delivery because there is constant connect between technology and business. The stories that we are working on are typically delivering the highest business value to the customers. The rejigging of the priority happens very regularly and happens in discussion with technology. The other benefit that we typically see of this alignment is that there is less accruing of technical debts. If your business and IT are really not talking, you will see that the IT is trying to convince the business that, look, these are the technical debt items that we need to take care of. And if we don't, you know, somewhere the product is not going to be giving us the optimal results and not going to be giving the most value to the customers. And the product will keep pushing on, no, you need to get more functional abilities out. But if the product and IT are aligned, they understand the need to have a consistent clearing of the technical debts. So these are some of the benefits that you will see with the alignment layer from the Agile transformation. The next layer, which probably is the most obvious and most visible and most felt layer, is the process transformation. Typically, the Scrum ceremonies and artifacts replace your traditional waterfall or God knows different methodologies that you have. This probably is the transformation layer that is the most visible. And I have a strong belief that the suboptimal outcome of our Agile transformation is that many people think that Agile is only a process transformation. Of course, there are the processes, the software development, requirement processes, all of those undergo change, and those are big part of it. But many people mistake that this is the only layer, whereas as we go see, this is a multi-layer a transformation. And typically you will have a role like a Scrum Master, which will bring in this transformation. I personally don't like the word Scrum Master. I personally like Scrum Champion, because that kind of delivers the message really well. This is a person who's the champion of the Scrum framework and helps team to understand why certain ceremonies need to be there. And that's where you will probably see more self-organizing, self-paced teams. Teams are selecting their own backlogs, teams are delivering based on their promises for their sprint goals. And hence the outcome that come out of it are fairly predictable. There is less spillover. You know, many of you kind of voted where, you know, you said that there is a spillover. If the teams are self-organizing, self-paced, and, you know, hopefully doing the scrum ceremonies right, we should get into a rhythm where we are constantly delivering to the velocity or to the promises that we are making. There are, you know, if we have the right kind of process transformation, we'll have quick feedback loops, not just with the reviews at the end of every sprint, but through several ways because the team is working together. And most importantly, the teams are self-improving. They need lesser direction from management. So typically when you get into this process transformation, these are the benefits that you see. And if you're not seeing these benefits, you really need to go back and see, you know, if your process transformation is where it is, where it needs to be. The next layer, which again is one of the most critical layers, is the engineering transformation layer. The core engineering practices may be the development, testing, deployment, monitoring. All of them really need to undergo massive change to make those practices efficient, nimble, more automated, and more integrated. You know, we've always heard CI/CD and DevOps to be the buzzwords, but really speaking, unless we get these fundamental practices right within the Scrum team, CI/CD and DevOps always remain the Pied Piper dream. So, and you will typically have the architects or test guild masters who will typically bring out this transformation. You should see that reduction in cycle times with this relentless automation. You should see that there is lesser integration overheads because of our continuous integration. I think this is one X factor that has really changed the game, the continuous integration part of it, as well as the continuous deployment later on. But you, unless you have continuous integration, there's no meaning for continuous deployment. Today, when we see, as I said, the retail giants putting out things out into production every day, there is a very stable, robust continuous integration set of practices that they have, and, you know, teams sitting across the globe are able to continuously integrate their work. Because of this high emphasis on matured engineering practices, the built-in quality is there, rather than leaving it till the end for some of the testing members to check the quality. The quality is built right from the beginning in terms of how the use cases, user stories are defined, how the development is being done, so on and so forth. And if you are really having matured engineering practices, then potentially shippable products at the end of every sprint is not just an aspiration, but you actually do that. If you're struggling to do this, if you're struggling to have potentially shippable product, more often than not, the answer is within your engineering transformation, not top of the model. And last but not the least, the most, again, one of the most cliched but still underachieved target is that of the mindset transformation. This is where not just the delivery team, but the entire ecosystem around you understands the importance of value delivery, understands the lean principles and the self-organizing nature of the teams, and the ecosystem starts becoming more of enablers, less directive. And typically the agile coaches would help us to achieve this. More often than not, I have seen that the agile coaches themselves or from the ecosystem, the expectation is that they will coach the delivery teams. But in my mind, the agile coaches should be working across the ecosystem and getting these principles really implemented, so that we can have an ecosystem that is driven by value delivery, not cost optimization. There is a big, I mean, we could actually have a separate session on cost optimization versus value delivery itself, but those of you who know, who've been working in Agile would know what value delivery is. High performing synchronized teams is probably something you are going to not going to deliver in one or two scrum teams now. You're probably going to deliver in web farms of scrum teams, and it is very important to bring in that synchronization. That probably is something that will come through your mindset transformation, reducing weight and improving efficiency. A motto that is not there only for the delivery team, but for the entire ecosystem. And when such kind of transformation starts happening, this kind of transformation is going to push the other cogs in the bigger wheel, meaning your support system like HR and finance. You know, very often than not, you will see that good, mature, agile organizations have got the HR also thinking in terms of making their practices agile. The finance also thinking in making their practices agile, may it be the more frequent feedbacks, performance feedback, or may it be business agility for the finance. Again, these are topics which are in itself can be topics of our discussion. But these are some of the things that you should expect with the agile transformation. Now, so, you know, before we go to our next and last poll, I just wanted to put this out there that what I'm saying is the agile transformation that happens through layers, alignment transformation, process transformation, engineering transformation, mindset transformation. And these are the enabler roles which will bring in this transformation. So let's quickly go to our next poll. I know we are running short of time, but I would love to hear from you on this, our last poll. And the last poll is, based on the discussion so far, which transformation enabler do you have in your ecosystem? Scrum Master and Product Owner, Scrum Master, Product Owner, Architects, both Dev and Testing, Scrum Master, Product Owner, Architects, and Agile Coaches are none of the enablers. So I'm going to launch this poll now. Please take a minute to complete it, take a look at it, you know, and vote carefully. This could be a little tricky question. I'm going to keep the poll open for some time now. So for those of you who cannot see the third option is Scrum Master, Product Owner, Architects, and Agile Coaches as well. Okay, I've got a feedback that some people are not able to see the poll, but I see that you have, I see the polls, votes are coming in. So sorry, Rajiv, there are others who are able to vote. I hope you get to vote eventually. I'm going to keep this poll open for a few more seconds so that I can get as many votes. Thank you, Rajiv, for the feedback. All right, let's. I'm going to close the poll. The results are that, you know, 11% say that they have only Scrum Masters. 14% are saying that they have Scrum Masters and Product Owners. A little more than one third are saying they have Architects also, and another one third are saying that they have Agile Coaches also along with it. So, but there are 8% which have none of the enablers. So maybe we need to go back in your organization and see what kind of enablers that we just talked about need to be there for this. So thank you everyone for giving your votes. So I mean, it's good that we've learned about the layers. How do we go about achieving these, making progress in these layers? Because typically this is how your transformation may look like. You may make progress in one layer more than other layers, and this is just a example, just a sample representative, guys. This doesn't mean that you will typically make more progress in alignment transformation, but you may get into a place where you made 60% progress in alignment, you've made, you know, only 15% progress in your engineering transformation, so on and so forth. So this sample representation is just showing you that you are making progress at a different place pace in each of the layers. So how is it that we can make sure that we are making progress well in each of the layers? Is probably this is where we go to the areas within transformation layer. I have kind of listed four areas within each of the transformation layer. And what you see is actually a representation from one of the assessments that we have done for one of our clients. And it's actually from the picture from their assessment. So their alignment progress was around 25% because they had, so the areas that I believe we should look at when the alignment is, do you have the right org structure? Is the vision regularly shared with the technology team? Is there synchronization between technology team and business as part of the cadence? And are there things that happen beyond the cadence? So, you know, having in typical SAFe parlance, for example, having PMT, CPT, and the delivery teams is a good org structure. But then are there mechanism governance established to have synchronizations across these layers? And beyond these defined governance or synchronizations, beyond this cadence, what is it that we are doing? So you see here that it's been 25% because it's really taking into account all these four areas within the alignment layer. Going to the next layer. Pallavi, can you please confirm if you are able to hear me?
Yes, I can hear.
And you are able to see my screen as well?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful. Sorry, guys. You know, as luck would have it, 4 to 5 is the time when my Wi-Fi goes for a toss. So quickly coming back to this, we talked about the alignment transformation. We talked about the process transformation layers and its areas. The next one, the engineering. So quality, architecture and design, construction and automation are the areas that you should be looking at. Quality, by quality, I just don't mean testing, but, you know, quality across the different activities that we do, what kind of architecture and design you have, what type of construction processes you have, what type of construction practices you have, and of course, a big part of it is the emphasis on automation. Last but not the least, the mindset, which is probably going to be the most difficult layer for us to keep making progress. As the name suggests, it deals with mindset, and that's probably the most complex software that we deal with, right? So some of the areas mentioned there are value-driven focus, transparency within the system. This is, again, it takes a lifetime to really achieve a decent amount of transparency across different layers within your organization. Adaptability, you know, today we are in this COVID situations. The organizations really would have to adapt to this situation, and, you know, their ability to adapt to difficult situation is really going to be tested. And organizations which have the right mindset, which are going to, you know, come out trumps in this situation. Is there a culture of continuous improvement across the layers within the organization? Will you know, give you a good insight into mindset. So today you see an objective view of this because we have an assessment framework which is based on this in Pfizer. You could probably, you know, come up with your own assessment framework which will look at these areas. So given all of this, what should really be the path forward for you to make progress into your agile transformation? The first is that you need to perform regular assessments, as I said, right? I mean, what framework that you use is really a matter of semantics, whether you use something homegrown, whether you use something that has been, you know, given to you by consultants. But you need to get into a habit of continuously looking and assessing the progress that you made into your transformation, which will then give rise to a certain set of actions. You need to make sure that those actions are acted upon, these recommendations from these assessments get the right kind of attention and priority for you to make kind of a progress. And last but not the least, a thorough governance through which you will verify the outcomes of the progress towards the agile drivers. Remember, this is an ongoing journey. Remember, although we have percentages, you will probably never be at 100% within each of these layers because this is an ongoing journey and something that you will keep improving. But making sure that you keep making that progress through governance, through processes that will have priority given to these assessments and the action items followed up from those assessments is something that we should really look at. That, my friends, is what I had today. I would like to end the session with saying, by putting a quote by Alistair Cockburn. Alistair Cockburn, most of you would know, is one of the brightest minds of our times. Someone who, you know, was a signatory for Agile Manifesto. What Alistair says is, Agile is an attitude. It's not a technique with boundaries. So we shouldn't really be asking, can I do Agile here? But what we should really be asking ourselves is, how would I act in an agile way here? So your agile transformation itself can be a journey where you can ask yourself this question: how would I act in the agile way in my agile transformation? So with that, I think I'm going to conclude my session. I hope I have, I mean, these are my coordinates. I hope I have at least 10 minutes by my watch, where we can open it for some questions. I would love to have some questions for you, Pallavi. If you can open the floor for some questions, or if someone have given you any advanced question, would love to field that at this time.
Sure. So yes,
guys,
we have
the chat window to post the questions, right, Pallavi?
Yes, so we can have a question and answer round right now. So let's I would request all the participants, you can keep posting for the questions. You can use this chat option, so we would like to answer all your questions right now. Okay, so we got one question from Nikhil Singh. Nikhil Singh has a question as, can we implement agile methodology in sustained engineering project like OS migrations?
Thanks, Nikhil, for the question. And the answer is absolutely yes. I would, you know, I mean, the philosophical answer was given in the quote that we just saw from Alistair. You know, we should be looking at not whether I can do agile, but whether how agile I can be by doing this. Having said that, the more practical answer to this would be that we have seen many sustained engineering teams where they have used Kanban way of adopting Agile, where, you know, it's a ticket-based work typically in sustained engineering. And the main focus is on maintaining the flow. So please work with your enablers in the organization to see if you can get your Kanban board implemented for your Agile, for your sustained engineering work, and you'll be able to you know, get benefits of the agile implementation. Thanks for the question.
Great. Thank you, Mayuresh. Okay, so we have one more question. It's very good question from Chandrasekhar Balasubramaniam. He's asking how to improve agile mindset in the organization.
All right, you probably need to hear the recording of the entire session, Chandrasekhar. That is exactly what we talked about here. The agile transformation really needs to be looked at from different angles. And as I mentioned, you know, kind of giving it a framework and making sure that the agile transformation is not only focused in few areas, but it's a well-rounded transformation across multiple layers that I just talked about. Chandrasekhar, I hope I answered your question. If I am not, you can always reach out to me and we can have a chat.
Thank you so much, Mayuresh. So we got our third question from Nutan Kumar. He's working as a Scrum Master, I believe. As he's asking, as a Scrum Master, I always struggle to keep balance between capacity and efforts. What you would like to comment on this?
Nutan, this is you know, there are two types of question. One is a good question and the other is a great question. You know, great question are the ones to which I have good answers. Good questions are ones which I can just say good question. This is probably one of those questions. I'm just kidding. But, you know, this is probably a struggle that not just you, multiple Scrum Masters are going to have. And, you know, I've dealt with multiple challenging situations in adopting Agile, Nutan, and more often than not, the answer is within our principles, right? I think if we go back to our principles and if we focus on value delivery, that is where I at least believe that we could you know, get an answer for this particular balance. There are many times we are trying to clog our teams with a lot of work not all of them is of the same priority, or not all of them is delivering the same business value to our team. So maybe the question has to be, and this is where your alignment layer really will come into play, is having a dialogue between the business and technology to see what is the more higher priority business value that we need to do, so that at the end of the sprints, we are, at the end of the sprints, at the end of the releases, we have satisfied outcomes. Outcomes, those are really adding value to your customer, and hopefully, more and bigger revenue for your organization. But one has to take that big picture view a short answer to your question could be that one has to take a big picture view to get this kind of a balance between capacity and value delivery.
All right. Thank you so much, Mayuresh. So we will be having our last question, which is from Bhupinder Singh, who is asking how to get rid of technical debt in agile transformation. It will be a long answer, but would like to have it in a short way.
Yeah. Thanks for reminding me about the time, Pallavi. Bhupinder, I think that's a very valid question and something that you will deal with. And I think, within the presentation, we've talked about that at two different places, right? Typically, a technical debt would be an outcome of your agile engineering transformation. If your engineering practices are solid, based on continuous improvement, based on adopting best practices, based on making sure that there is built-in quality, the way you built the code, you should actually not have technical debts. But hey, even the Netflixes of this world and Amazons of this world haven't gotten rid of their technical debts. So over the years, you will accrue the technical debts. The way to get rid of that technical debt, though, so one aspect is making sure that we don't accrue a lot of technical debt. But the other aspect of that is making sure that the technical debt gets prioritized in your backlog. I have seen good agile teams where they had taken a guideline that in a sprint, they would have a mix of 80-20, meaning 80% of the stories will be of functional nature, 20% of the stories will be in technical in nature. That's how they've been chipping away on the technical debt that they would have incurred or accrued over a period of time. Bhupinder, I hope that again, that answers your question to some extent. Again, my coordinates are there on the screen. Please reach out. I would love to have a chat on Agile to anyone. Hopefully, post-COVID situation, a chat over coffee would be a great idea, which is something that I've always enjoyed. All right, I think
thank you so much, Mayuresh.
That's the end of our presentation. Pallavi, thank you very much for Novel Vista to giving me this opportunity to get in front of such a big audience. Having 650 plus is really a big number, and I haven't been fortunate enough to talk to so many people at the same time. So thank you very much, Pallavi.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot, Mayuresh, for delivering this session. And it's a pleasure to have such a great experienced agile head like you to be as a speaker today. It's a pleasure. Thanks a lot for delivering this session.
Thank you.
Yeah, I would like to thank all our participants as well who had participated for this webinar today. It's been more than 2 months we are delivering this session. We have delivered more than 20 plus webinars for all of you. And we got really good attendance, really good amount of response from you guys. We got 15,000 plus attendance till now for all this webinar series. And we would like to have your feedback, would like to have the response of what you can give it to your learning and development team, your HR team, so we can keep doing these activities for those webinars in complete May month and hence for June as well. So would like to request you to post us with the feedback through your HR and L&D team. Thank you so much for this webinar. Thanks a lot, Mayuresh.
Thank you, Pallavi.
Thank you.
I will stop sharing my.
Thank you. Thanks. Bye.